Tomorrow all the things were gone. I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt.
How?
It's being said that the conflict between our motherland and the French has come across the pond to our own soil. We must fight the battle now for ourselves and our Lady England.
before you die, know that I will put under the knife your children, so I will wipe your seed from the earth forever.
When it comes to books in American history, it's hard to find a novel that had a bigger impact than Thomas Paine's Common Sense. The message it sent brought out the idea of independence, and it caused colonists to become angry with Britain. Before this book, most colonists didn't care about seceding from Britain. Thomas Paine sparked a fire known as the American Revolution.
Today, we are going to talk about the infamous Boston Massacre. It broke out when a soldier opened fire on the crowd surrounding the British soldiers. The incident was an accident. However, it was used as propaganda, like the Boston Massacre etching by Paul Revere, to sway the colonials toward the idea of independence. 3 years later, the Tea Act was passed by English Parliament, taxing the tea imported to the colonies. In response, the Sons of Liberty dumped the tea into the harbor. This is a huge demonstration of the frustration of the colonies from the taxation without representation. Finally, in 1775, Paul Revere and William Dawes rode their infamous ride, saying,
"The British! They're coming! Get to the horses!"
The next day, the battle at Lexington and Concord took place. And finally, the British surrendered at Yorktown, Virginia in 1781. The Treaty of Paris formally ended the war in 1783. 5 years later, the American Constitution was signed and ratified. It is still in effect today. Later that year, the Second Continental Congress met, and a year later, on July 4th, 1776, the Declaration of Independence was signed. The war continued. And in 1778, the United States allied with the French.
In the early 1800s, inventions such as the steel plow created by John Deere and Eli Whitney's cotton gin made agriculture and industry grow within the South. Steamboats made it possible for trade to expand upriver, and Samuel Slater started a movement in the North which would lead to the foundation of many mills. And with that, the Industrial Revolution was born.
In present-day America, there are many factories, which produce enormous amounts of goods each day. Factories were first used in Great Britain, but thanks to our good friend Samuel Slater, America soon began to catch up.
How the British factories worked were kept a secret. But when I came over to America in 1790, I had all the ideas in my head. I built Slater's Mill, which was opened in 1793 and was the most advanced mill in all America.
Next came the Lowell Mills, with the most advanced spinning and power looms. Mills would soon change the American way of life. Even the old tradition of apprenticeships and artisans started to fade as unskilled workers could do work that previously required training. The putting out system grew in popularity as well. The putting out system consisted of home workers that were supplied to complete steps of the production of goods in their homes. In addition to changes in the way people worked, there were also changes in the way factories ran. Mechanization allowed unskilled workers to do many jobs and replace the bartering system. Standardization began when Eli Whitney first attempted to make interchangeable gun parts that would allow for the replacement of broken parts instead of buying a new item. By the end of the 19th century, 2/3 of American workers were wage workers. Unfair working conditions would lead to labor unions and labor strikes that would continue into the 21st century. Industries grew in many other ways, too. In 1913, it took 13 hours to produce a Ford car, and one car was finished every 90 minutes. By 1925, Ford finished one car every 10 seconds with the invention of the assembly line. the assembly line is still essential to mass production today. With the mass production of goods, convenience stores took business away from specialty stores. Even mail-order catalogs became available to order goods. Improvements in transportation allowed products to be shipped around the country. In 1825, the Erie Canal was completed. Canals allowed for shipping from the coast to the interior of the United States. Robert Fulton invented the steamboat in 1803. The steamboat allowed goods to be transported upstream as well as downstream and in a shorter period of time. In addition to canals, the Transcontinental Railroad was completed in 1869. It promoted westward movement and allowed for settlement and shipping to the west. The beginning of mills in America started the Industrial Revolution that would lead America's industries to where they are today.
Welcome to the idea of expansion. It all started in 1804 when Lewis and Clark went on an expedition to explore the Missouri River and the Oregon Territory. Then, in 1811, the construction of the National Road began. This helped connect the East to the West. Also, the Erie Canal connected New York and the Great Lakes and the Northwestern Territory. The idea of manifest destiny came in the 1840s. This was the belief that the United States should control all of North America. Through the 1848 war with Mexico, the U.S. acquired California and the Southwest. In 1851, the Indian Appropriations Act made it so that Western tribes were put onto agricultural reservations. A series of treaties were signed with several different tribes to make it so that their territories would allow passage through them and exchangement with the tribes for payments would be available. In 1854, the Kansas-Nebraska Act was signed. This allowed the slavery question in Kansas and Nebraska to be decided by popular vote. This decision triggered many bloody battles between pro- and anti-slavery groups in Kansas. This created much conflict in the West. 1862 came, and the Homestead Acts encouraged settlement of unoccupied Western lands. Also, the Union Pacific Railroad authorized to build a line from Nebraska to Utah to meet the Central Pacific. In 1867, the Treaty of Venison Lodge supposedly made many tribes agree to move onto reservation lands, but the treaty was disavowed by many tribal leaders. With 1868 came the Nez Perce Treaty. This was the last Indian treaty ratified by the U.S. government. The Transcontinental Railroad was completed, where the Union Pacific and the Central Pacific Railroads met in Promontory Point, Utah. This was in 1869. In 1871, the Indian Appropriation Act ended the treaty system and mandated that all future relations would be conducted by congressional statutes or executive orders. Indians were no longer legally considered members of the nations. In 1874, gold was discovered in the Black Hills, one of the most sacred lands of the Lakota Indians. This gold rush prompted the Second Sioux War. In 1885, Congress forbidden unauthorized fencing of public lands in the West. In 1887, the Dawes Act reduced Indian land holdings by allotting only 160 acres to the heads of families and 80 acres to individuals. Surplus lands on the reservations were opened up to white settlement. In 1889, the Indian Territory, also known as Oklahoma, was opened to white homesteaders. 50,000 settlers raced across the land to try to claim all 1.92 million acres by sunset. In 1893, many estimated that fewer than 2,000 buffalo remained of the more than 20 million that once roamed the Western Plains. This is one of the impacts of Western expansion.
We'll be right back. Tensions between the North and the South were prompted by westward expansion. The states were decided to be free or slave states by popular sovereignty. This escalated tensions because the South wanted more slave states and the North wanted more free states. Compromises were devised to try and to settle these tensions, like the Missouri Compromise in 1820, the Compromise of 1850, and the Kansas-Nebraska Act. The Missouri Compromise stated that Missouri could be a slave state if Maine was admitted as a free state, and no state above the parallel 36-30 degrees could be a slave state. The Compromise of 1850 ended the slave trade in Washington, D.C., made Texas annex land in New Mexico, admitted California as a free state, and also passed the Fugitive Slave Act, stating all runaway slaves must be brought back to their masters. The Kansas-Nebraska Act repealed the Missouri Compromise by allowing the states of Kansas and Nebraska to be decided free or slave states based on popular sovereignty. James Buchanan, the president before Abraham Lincoln, did nothing to aid these tensions. After Lincoln became president in 1860, southern states started to secede from the Union, starting with South Carolina, followed by Mississippi, Florida, Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, and Texas. The next year, the Civil War broke out, and Virginia, Arkansas, Tennessee, and North Carolina seceded as well. In 1863, the famous Battle of Gettysburg took place, which was a pivotal point for the North in the war. Later that year, Lincoln gave the Gettysburg Address, stating how men were equal under the Constitution and also the importance of keeping the Union together. In 1865, General Robert E. Lee of the Confederacy surrendered, and Lincoln was later assassinated by John Wilkes Booth. He was the first president to be assassinated. Later that year, slavery was abolished.
With the rise of newspapers and territory across the nation, someone was bound to stand up to society and push the limits through propaganda. No one did this better than Thomas Nast. He is responsible for so many political drawings and is often referred to as the father of the American cartoon. Think of how we view Santa Claus and even Uncle Sam today. You know how the Republicans are represented by an elephant while the Democrats are by a donkey? Well, that is because Thomas Nast drew them out to be that way, and those symbols still exist in today's society. It seems he deserves a lot more credit than he is given.
Hello there, I'm Kaylee Ennis with A Push News, here to bring you the story of the 1800s reformers. Here's a little intro for ya. It took an intellectual reorientation, as well as improved technologies of printing and transportation, to create an expansion of reform that began around 1815 and continued through the Civil War. The Temperance Movement. Sorry, one of our light men have a gippy arm. Welcome back. The first topic we're covering today is the Temperance Movement. Now, the consumption of hard liquor had grown in the U.S. dramatically. Like, we're talking big. Working men were spending their wages on alcohol instead of rent or food for their family. And you know what? They were absent from their factory jobs. Let's hear from a woman who put a lot of work to make this come to an end. Miss Stanton?
Tell me a little bit more about your movement, Miss Stanton.
I began the Women's Christian Temperance Union. Our group focused on making alcohol illegal, and our movement continued until the 18th Amendment was passed.
The next topic of the day is improving public education. Guess what? The demand for public education began to grow as the need for a more educated electorate was deemed important. Factory workers wanted their children to have more things than they were able to have themselves. A reformer of this time period was Horace Mann, and trust me, he had a good plan. Mann?
I'm the first secretary of the Massachusetts State Board of Education. I passed school attendance laws, structured curricula, and implemented and designed teacher training and youth placement systems.
The abolitionist movement. The movement was initially started in 1836 when the House of Representatives passed the gag rule. This prohibited debate or discussion on the topic of slavery. People reacted.
They reacted by submitting petitions to Congress. And they called for the abolition of slavery and the slave trade in the District of Columbia. Want more information? Let's turn to William Lloyd Garrison, the leader of this reformation.
I published the anti-slavery paper, The Liberator, in 1831. My group wanted immediate abandonment of slavery without compensation to slaveholders. Frederick Douglass was the main speaker of our group.
Women's rights movements. It was begun by Miss Stanton, of course. The movement actually began in Seneca Falls, New York, in 1848 by none other than Miss Stanton and her friend Lucretia Mott. You know, whatever. Miss Stanton, she drafted a statement of women's rights. Which later became known as the Declaration of Sentiments and Resolutions. It called for the equality for women, before the law, equal employment opportunity, and the right to vote. However, many of these things did not get fixed until later in time. But you know what? No matter what, let's turn to Miss Stanton, and we'll look at her beautiful efforts on going towards this cause. Elizabeth Cady Stanton, folks.
This movement gave women the ability to participate more in public life. Despite our efforts, it was not until the 19th Amendment that women got the right to vote, and later that the issues of equal employment and full legal and social equality were addressed.
The utopian communities. During the period of 1820 to 1850, utopian communities were created with the belief that they would put an end to society's problems more effectively than other reform movements that were already going on. All of the utopian communities eventually failed. However, a few were more successful than others. One in particular was Oneida Community, and that was founded by Sir Humphrey Noyes. Prison and asylum reform. Before this woman's work, prisons were a place for women, men, and children, all bunched together. Everyone who gave offense to society. This means that those who spit in public would be bunched together with those who committed murder and kept in the worst conditions. Dorothy Dix was a woman with a vision, and she led this reformation.
I had a revolutionary idea that society, rather than individuals, had the responsibility for criminal activity and had the duty to treat neglected children and rehabilitate alcoholics.
Hello there, I'm Kaylee Ennis with A Push News. I'd like to give a special thanks to all my viewers and to all the people that were guests today on my show. And more especially, I'd like to give a special thanks, that's awful special, to my lighting man, Stan. Stan, the show's over.
Where am I?
Stan's been asleep.
Hello, boys and girls. I'm here to talk to you today about the Progressive Era, a time frame in U.S. history where the world went from the Old West to the bustling cities of New York City. In regards to the progressive movement, there was an author in the late 1800s by the name of Jacob Riis. And he was a photographer who went around the lower parts of Manhattan and introduced the world to the living conditions of immigrants. He was a true leader in the progressive era because he exposed all of the awful conditions that people were living in. People lived in one-bedroom apartments where they had probably 7-8 people living in basically a 12-by-12 space. Also, conditions people lived in dealt with outhouses that were in back of these massive apartment buildings called tenement buildings. And again, just think of the conditions under which people had to deal with day in and day out. No clean drinking water, food was very difficult to come by, and until modern plumbing and until modern roads, everything ended up in the street. So when we would say to our kids, hey, go out and play in the street, they went out and played in the street, and in a lot of cases those kids died from getting diseases like typhoid and diphtheria and things like that. So kudos to Jacob Riis in bringing about reforms in the ways in which people lived on a daily basis. Another component to the Progressive Era was a gentleman by the name of Upton Sinclair, who wrote a very famous telling book about the meatpacking industry in the United States. For more information on Upton Sinclair, we're going to send it out to our news reporter, Mr. Jared Clough.
The Jungle, written by Upton Sinclair, is a graphic novel that showed the dangerous conditions immigrants faced while working in the meatpacking industry during the Progressive Era. After this book was published, Congress passed several acts of employment that dealt with safety, meeting, and job standards. It's easy to say that this is one of the most eye-opening books in American history because of its view on sanitation in the meatpacking industry.
Go.
Awesome. Awesome. Thanks, Jared, for that piece on Upton Sinclair. It's important to note that Upton was responsible for two major acts that were passed by Congress in the early 1900s. The first being the Meat Inspection Act, which simply meant that all ingredients that went into a product, specifically sausage, hot dogs, all those fun-loving treats, all of that had to be verified and put on a label. Same thing occurred with the second law, which was called the Pure Food and Drug Act. Anything that was sold to the consumers had to be proven that it was a legitimate product. You no longer could basically sell a remedy that's going to cure the common cold and it just being alcohol. So, well done, Upton. Thanks. Ida B. Tarbell wrote a book called The History of Standard Oil, and it's an expose on the workings of John D. Rockefeller, who owned Standard Oil. At that time, her expose, which was a classic example of the muckrakers who did all these expose writings about the big business, but it's her book that really brought about the end of Standard Oil. Congress again passed a law preventing companies like Standard Oil from monopolizing every single aspect of the oil industry. Her book led to the end of companies like U.S. Steel, who also played along the same lines as John D. Rockefeller. So with Tarbell's book, with works like Upton Sinclair and Jacob Riis, we do find that the Progressive Era did bring about great changes for the American people.
Oh, hey kids, I'm Peter Fitzgerald, and today we'll be looking at the wonderful world of U.S. history.
Before we get to the lesson, let me slip into something more comfortable. So grab your pillows, your pen and paper, and let's get to this.
I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay. I sleep all night and I work all day. He's a lumberjack and he's okay. Sleeps all night. Oh, I'm glad to see you're finally ready. Well, do you have everything you need? Pens? Paper? Pillows? That's good. All right, there are four main causes that started the World War I as we know it. Imperialism, nationalism, mutual defense alliances, and militarism. First off, imperialism. That's when all the countries, at the time they were going into places like Africa and trying to build their wealth by conquering territories.
nationalism. Who's not proud of their country? And who's not willing to fight for their country? This could cause some aggression between the countries. Mutual defense alliances. Countries were obligated to aid their other allied nations. Militarism. Other countries would build up their armies to try to intimidate the others. This led to the catastrophic scale that the war could be held on. These factors compounded to make the perfect fuel to start a war. But what could set them off? Well, the answer lies with the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Oh, hey kids, it's about time I tell you about the Bolshevik Revolution, eh? Well, first let me slip into something more comfortable. While most of the world was preoccupied with the start of World War I, many Americans were more concerned about the Russian Revolution, or Bolshevik Revolution. The spread of communism in Russia had startled America, and they feared their democratic state may be in danger. This resulted in a lot of trials. Distant lover. Sorry, where was I? This resulted in a lot of trials involving free speech. Oh, hey kids, and welcome back to the wonderful world of U.S. history. Well, last time we left off with how the war started. Now let's say how America got involved. But first, let me slip into something more comfortable. For most of the war, America tried to stay neutral. However, as the war dragged on, them favoring the Allies became apparent. And Germany took action. Pop quiz. Today is June 4th, 2012. What happened 97 years, 1 month, and 3 days ago? Time's up. 1,959 people died on the Lusitania, 128 of which were U.S. civilians. How might the Lusitania have been sunk? U-boats. German U-boats. As if the Lusitania wasn't enough, another problem arose. Germany, of course. Well, they got Mexico involved with the Zimmermann Note. This was a transmission done by George Zimmerman, and it was intercepted by the British. It was meant to go to Mexico, and they told Mexicans to start a war with the U.S., and this would occupy them. Well, the British gave it to us, and we didn't like it. So we finally, once for all, went to war. It got real.
A whole new style of warfare was created when World War I broke out. Countries discovered a whole new set of weapons, such as machine guns and mustard gas. It was the first war that consisted of planes, tanks, and even submarines, and the use of cavalry were pretty much disappearing. Battles became more ugly, and it was only going to get worse in years to come.
Yeah, you. You go. Come on over here. No way, man. You go. Hey, you go. We could be here all day. Just go already. I said it first. You go. No way. I'm not doing it. Come on. Come on. Get over here.
You did ask you first.
Might as well.
Excuse me.
Okay.
There you go.
Oh, hey kids. World War I finally ended in 1918, and the Treaty of Versailles, the next step to recuperating the European nations, was signed on June 28, 1919. Important politicians there were David Lloyd George of Britain, George Clemenceau of France, and Woodrow Wilson of the United States. The victors from World War I weren't in any mood whatsoever to cooperate, and being very angry with Germany, decided to punish them as harsh as they could. Some of the things that they ended up signing on in the actual treaty. Land was taken away from Germany, their army was reduced to only 100,000 men, and they were not allowed any tanks whatsoever. The loss of vital industrial territory would be a severe blow to any attempts to rebuild their economy, which is why we know they paid hundreds of thousands of francs for just bread. And they only had two choices. They couldn't not sign the treaty or else they'd just be invaded again. So they weren't very well off whatsoever. And this was partially how the League of Nations were created, and this would have happened even if Germany was excluded from it.
October 29th, a day that has lived in infamy for many generations. Some see it as the start of the Great Depression. Others just see it as a day when they lost millions of dollars. Black Tuesday, October 29th, 1929, is a day when 16 million shares were traded furiously across the Wall Street stock market floors. Since that time, the economy went down into an economic downfall. It would be easy to blame the Great Depression on the stock market crash. However, during the 1920s, stocks were very popular among upper-class citizens and middle class that could afford it. See, banks, businesses, investors all started to see what a big profit they were able to make off the stock market. It grew 200% during the 1920s. That's a lot of inflation with not many results. And what happened is when the stock market eventually crashed, it was largely in part due to an overproduction of products and not enough people to buy them. Unfortunately, this meant that many businesses saw it fit to cut production down, which meant many people losing their jobs when they already couldn't afford enough as it was. Because of this, many middle-class and lower-class families suffered. As with any time in American history, the wealthiest portion of the nation did not fare as bad off as the rest of us. In fact, the wealthiest 5% of the nation had 30% of the nation's total profits, while the bottom 60% had the nation's 26% of total profits. The remaining 10% were considered middle class, and they had what was ever left over.
My mother and I went to West Mansfield to deposit that check in the Farmers Bank. We noticed in the lobby that there were several well-dressed people transacting business. They took my mother's check as a deposit. The next day, President Roosevelt declared the bank holiday. It was a long time in the future before the folks received their money. Those well-dressed people, of which I spoke, were the forewarned stockholders making a run on the bank. The Farmers Bank was never reopened.
My dad was a skilled tradesman and a builder, and was out of work starting in the fall of 1929. There was no unemployment insurance or other aid available. All savings, including my $34 college fund, were used completely. Even the furniture was disassembled, searching for long-lost coins. Excellent character and good credit reputation provided coal and food until the spring of 1930. Finally, City Relief, a bitter experience for proud parents, gave us basic food. A two-week supply included 4 pounds of navy beans and 3 pounds of green peas. With these ingredients, we had soup made without meat 5 nights a week, every week. We were given enough cornmeal and oatmeal, which we had for breakfast. Our brown bag lunches were peanut butter sandwiches. We had plenty of bread and milk for a healthy yet boring diet.
My mother managed to hold on to our family's Singer sewing machine. She used it to fix up hand-me-downs into wearable pieces. I was the youngest of three. All of my clothes had to be altered after my two older sisters had worn them. Often I would grow to like clothes that they disliked just so I would have something nicer to wear when they were done with it. But my mother could work magic with the sewing machine. One time she changed a ripped skirt into a pair of pants.
At the onset of the Great Depression, President Herbert Hoover was leading our fine nation. Him, like many other politicians of the time, denied that a depression was even occurring. Unfortunately, they eventually had to accept the fact. And in 1932, President Herbert Hoover established the Reformation Corporation Organization. However, due to the lack of spending and lack of funds in general, it was highly ineffective. President Hoover's growing unpopularity was evident in the mockery of his name, as it was loaned to such words as Hoover veils, Hoover blankets, and Hoover leather.
I remember 1934 like the back of my hand. When I was a young boy, I lived in a Hooverville. I remember one time I was setting up my Hoover house when a Hoover girl stole my Hoover blankets. Whenever I became sad, I would lighten the mood with some Hoover ball. I was always picked first, for obvious reasons. I would go Hoover diving to find fresh food and cardboard for my family. I was sad.
I was born in 1933, so I have no memory of the dust storms. However, I do remember my parents talking about them. They said they would wet rags to stuff around the windows, and yet in the morning they had to sweep the house out. My mother said she would wet tea towels and drape them over my crib where she put me to bed at night. In the morning, you could see the outline of my body on the crib sheets. My father worked on the Chevrolet dealership, which was about 4 blocks from our house. My dad would walk home for lunch every day. One dust storm day, he called mother to tell her that he was on his way home. She put a lamp on the window to help guide him to the house. He walked into the side of the house before he knew he was there.
Illness and injuries were handled much differently in those days. There was no emergency squad or emergency room. Most people did their own doctoring. They used castor oil, soap and water soaks, Epsom salts, worm oil put in an aching ear, or someone who smoked blowing smoke into an aching ear. Other ointments were brought from the traveling Watkins man. When I was 4 years old, I was knocked unconscious by a rock thrown by another child. The children carried me to a nearby house where I was revived and the blood was washed off my head with a cool wet cloth. The children carried me home. No doctor was called and my hair was covered the untreated scar for 81 years. I had whooping cough, chicken pox, and other illnesses without a doctor. People had no money for doctors. When my finger was shut in the neighbor's car door, my mom had me walk around for a couple days with my finger in a cup of warm water that had turpentine in it. The finger is crooked, but it works. We learned about deaths when a neighbor hung a black wreath on their door. And when I was in the third grade, I learned how a big orange sign on the porch that said quarantine and the red-eyed mother saying don't stop for Rebecca anymore told me that my best friend had died. Maxine Bartelt, age 85, Columbus.
In 1932, a new face was brought into the White House. President Franklin D. Roosevelt won the election with an electoral vote percentage of 89%. His campaign motto was, "I pledge you, I pledge myself to a new deal for the American people," and a new deal he brought. In what is known as the 100 Days, President Franklin D. Roosevelt passed through Congress many Reformation Acts that would aid the American people.
The Emergency Baking Relief Act, the Civilian Conservation Corps, and the Public Works Administration.
I recall the fireside chats in which President Roosevelt talked to the American people and offered reassurance during these difficult times. In order to put men back to work, much was accomplished in our town through the federal WPA. A list of projects that I can see today, yet two new concrete bridges, two state routes into the city, a new modern sports stadium, and a new combined city hall, police, and fire station. Another example of the works projects was the turning of the bricks on a few of our residential brick streets. Over many years prior, the bricks became somewhat rounded, similar to appearance of cobblestone streets as a result of years of wear from horse-drawn buggies, wagons, etc. Large numbers of jobless men would be hired to turn the bricks 180 degrees, which would then reveal the reverse, flat side of the brick. Another works project that was created during the FDR first and second terms in office, young men joined the CCC. A works project that my brother-in-law entered. His unit was involved in forestry, and the work made men of them.
I can remember my grandmother making soup from dandelions. My mother and father would go out in the fields to get the flowers. It didn't have much to it, but it was more than having nothing. My father also taught me how to grease a pan. You would swipe the fork through a lard cloth to grease it, and wipe off as much as possible to leave the least amount possible. We had to live simply, poorly, just to survive. Our strength came from a deep sense of what was right and what was wrong. To this day, most of us follow those lessons learned in a difficult time of our lives. Help each other, don't hurt each other, share what you have, pull together. If you follow that advice from another time, your life will be better.
The Great Depression was an infamous time in American history due to the social implications that it had on our society. But from that time, many people remember it as a time of poverty and economic downfall. But from those lessons we learned, we have turned into the economic powerhouse we are today.
Another chapter in history. World War II started September 1st, 1939, when Germany invaded Poland. The people of the United States had no interest in being involved in the war.
The least we can do is to try to help Britain, France, and China without actually entering the war.
Congress soon passed the Neutrality Act of 1939, which states that the U.S. was not picking sides but would sell arms to any country who wanted them. The Land-Lease Act soon followed the Neutrality Act and states the and allows the sale, exchange, or lease of arms to any country whose defense appeared vital to U.S. security, mostly Britain and France.
When Japan sides with Nazi Germany, Roosevelt freezes Japanese assets in the U.S. and cuts off their oil supplies. Because of this, on December 7, 1941, the Japanese bomb Pearl Harbor, and on December 8, Roosevelt signs the official declaration of war.
Mr. President?
The Atlantic Charter that Roosevelt and Churchill decide on is to first fight the threat of Germany and then go on to Japan.
At the famous Battle of Midway, the U.S. defeated, or destroyed, the Japanese Navy. Japan's shipbuilding and pilot training programs were unable to keep pace in replacing their losses, while the U.S. steadily increased its output in both areas. In August 1942, the Manhattan Project starts. For those of you who don't know what this is, it's the beginning of the atomic bomb.
The Manhattan Project consisted of some of the brightest scientists around the world. Together, they only had one goal, and that was to create a weapon like no other. A weapon that could end a war within seconds.
They didn't know the exact damage that it would cause or even if it would work. But in the end, it would kill hundreds of thousands of people and would become known as the deadliest weapon mankind had ever seen, the atomic bomb.
And that'll be the explosion.
After the Germans had taken France, Operation Overlord was put in place to invade Europe. June 6, 1944 was called D-Day. This is when the army landed on the beaches of Normandy and stormed up them. This was the turning point of the war, when we started to regain land from Germany.
February 1945, the Yalta Conference was where the three main powers set up what was going to happen after the war was over. Joseph Stalin wanted the Baltic states and part of Poland, where Roosevelt said that was okay, but wanted the Pacific Islands. And Churchill wanted Britain's lost empire in Asia. When Roosevelt dies on April 12th and Truman becomes president, he then learns about the new atomic bomb.
On April 3rd, Hitler commits suicide, and soon after, Germany surrenders. Then the U.S. began focus on Japan. On August 3rd, Japan refuses total surrender. They soon get a letter telling Tojo, head of the Japanese defense, that the U.S. has a bomb that would destroy a city. They had to surrender, or their city was going to explode. Japan didn't listen, and on August 6, 1945, the U.S. dropped its first atomic bomb on Hiroshima. Then, 3 days later, on the 6th, the second bomb was dropped on Nagasaki. On December 2, 1945, Japan officially surrenders, ending World War II. This kiss, unstoppable.
Following World War II, Germany was divided into East and West Germany. The Cold War began due to Soviet mistrust in the U.S. possession of the atomic bomb. In June of 1948, the Soviet Union blockaded West Berlin to cut off the Western Allies from the city. The U.S. response was to drop supplies into West Berlin. In May 1949, the Soviets lifted the blockade, and this became known as the Berlin Airlift. Between 1945 and 1949, the United States was the only world atomic superpower. But in 1949, the Soviet tested the first atomic bomb and began the arms race that lasted from the 1950s up to the 1990s. The Truman Doctrine pledged the U.S. to halt the spread of communism. The Korean War began when North Korea invaded Democratic South Korea. The U.S. and the United Nations intervened to halt the spread of communism. But following the invasion of North Korea, the Chinese entered the war. This resulted in a stalemate that would eventually lead to the armistice that would end the war. The Cold War prompted the creation of many agencies in both the United States and Russia, the most important of these being espionage agencies such as the CIA and Russian KGB. It also led to a great technological advancements in espionage technology, such as the U-2 spy plane, the SR-71, and finally, the modern F-117 stealth fighter. In 1959, Fidel Castro led a communist revolution in Cuba to overthrow the U.S.-backed Batista government. Initially trying to work with the United States, but upon being ignored by the Eisenhower administration, went to the Soviet Union. The Cuban Missile Crisis began when the Soviet Union attempted to install medium-range nuclear missiles in Cuba. In response, President John Fitzgerald Kennedy blockaded Cuba to prevent the missile construction. At last minute, Nikita Khrushchev orders the ships to turn around and agrees to withdraw the missiles if the U.S. will also withdraw outdated missiles in Turkey. This would become the closest point to nuclear war. Following French failure to hold on to their colonies in French Indochina, North Vietnam was split into the Communist North and the Capitalist South. The North, led by Ho Chi Minh, and the South, by Ngo Dinh Diem. Starting in the late 50s, President Eisenhower sent small groups of military advisors to South Vietnam, these numbers increasing under Kennedy.
The space race began during the Cold War, when tensions were strong between the Soviet Union and the United States because of communism and political and military controversy. It began in 1955 when both countries, just 4 days apart, announced their plans to launch artificial satellites. Just 2 years later, on October 4th, the Soviet Union launched Sputnik, the first artificial satellite. This was a huge deal. Not only did it cause people to lose faith in the United States, but it also forced people to realize the hard truth. If the Soviet Union could send a satellite into space, they could also send nuclear weapons, and the U.S. would have no way to fight back. Not surprisingly, the United States responded with their first satellite, Explorer 1, just 4 months later. In 1961, the Soviet Union beat us again when they sent their first living being, a dog, Laika, into orbit, and when a while later, the first person. The United States decided to fight back full force. Kennedy, the president at the time, addressed a large crowd with his famous "We Choose the Moon" speech.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the others too.
And we succeeded in this mission. On July 16th, 1969, the Saturn V rocket containing Apollo 11 was launched. Apollo 11 contained a 3-man crew and was destined for the moon. Just 4 days later, Neil Armstrong became the first man to set foot on the moon. As he stepped onto the surface for the first time, his words echoed across the world.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
The civil rights movement started in 1954 with the Supreme Court's decision in the case of Brown versus the Board of Education. This case overturned the separate but equal decision made in the Plessy versus Ferguson case. This new movement started off slowly, but quickly gained momentum with the largely publicized bus boycott. The bus boycott was started when an African-American woman refused to give up her seat on a bus to a white male and was arrested for it. This woman was Rosa Parks, and she is largely credited for starting the civil rights movement. With the start of the bus boycott came the start of Martin Luther King Jr. as a leader of the civil rights movement. Martin Luther King Jr. was the leader and president of multiple civil rights groups, including the Montgomery Improvement Association and the Southern Christian Leadership
Conference. Martin Luther King Jr. was the biggest figure of the civil rights movement and had the largest impact. King led many nonviolent protests as he preached the ideas that all men are created equal and deserve the same rights. He had a tremendous amount of successful protests and even won the Nobel Peace Prize, becoming the youngest to ever receive this award. Out of all of Martin Luther King Jr.'s protests, the most famous was his March on Washington. It was at this protest where he gave his "I Have a Dream" speech.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood? I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream. Shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it today.
Coincidentally, Martin Luther King Jr. was also assassinated at the age of 39. King had such a large impact that on the third Monday of every January, we take a day to remember his life and all he accomplished.
While Martin Luther King Jr. was conducting nonviolent protests, Malcolm X was doing the opposite. In the time of the Civil Rights Movement, Malcolm X was working for the Nation of Islam. He was conducting violent protests and was attempting to convert people to the Muslim religion. After Malcolm X visited Mecca, Saudi Arabia, he changed his ideals on Islamic life. This change angered the leader of the Nation of Islam, and due to this, they had him assassinated at the young age of 39. Also in 1965, Congress passed the Voting Act of 1965, which made it easier for Southern African Americans to register to vote. This act made it so that Southern states could no longer force African Americans to take literacy tests, pay poll taxes, and other such requirements that were used to restrict African American voting. Later, Civil Rights Act of 1968 would be signed. This prohibited discrimination in the sale, rental, and financing of housing. In 1965, President Lyndon B. Johnson signed Executive Order 11246. This executive order prohibited discrimination and called for affirmative action. By putting affirmative action into place, many African Americans were being treated more as equals, as they were being employed and mistreatment along with discrimination was prohibited in the workplace. The last act of violence to take place in this movement took place in 1992. Riots took place in Los Angeles, California, after the ruling of two white cops being declared innocent after they brutally beat African-American Rodney King. This caused many African-Americans in Los Angeles and in surrounding areas to riot in the streets. In 1967, the Supreme Court made its ruling in the case of Loving v. Virginia. They ruled that prohibiting interracial marriage is unconstitutional. There were 16 states that still banned interracial marriage at the time, but they were forced to reverse their laws.
Under Lyndon Johnson, the war was escalated. The U.S. committed significantly more combat troops and started bombing raids and authorized use of advanced warfare. The U.S. fought a limited war, meaning that troops could only act defensively, it could only act by strict orders. Up until 1968, the U.S. was winning the war. But in 1968, the Viet Cong attacked every major city in South Vietnam. The U.S. repelled the attack, but the attacks later contributed to anti-war sentiment because news footage depicted the U.S. on the losing side. It became a military disaster for the Viet Cong, but a symbolic victory and a turning point.
Sit down. Shut up.
Plane crashed here.
The worst possible situation right now is a half-naked Charlotte running right at us. Oh, there he is! Yeah. Sit down, shut up!
Upon his election, Richard Nixon began withdrawing U.S. combat troops from Vietnam and escalating the bombings into Cambodia, Laos, and North Vietnam. By 1975, the U.S. had fully withdrawn from South Vietnam, and the North Vietnamese invaded and conquered South Vietnam. The Berlin Wall's construction began in 1961, quickly becoming a symbol of Soviet oppression, but was torn down in 1989. The Afghan-Soviet War was a 9-year war between the Soviet Union and the Mujahideen Freedom Fighters, and began when KGB agents assassinated the Afghan president and destroyed communications throughout the country. It is considered the Soviet Vietnam. The Soviets conquer and occupy Afghanistan and begins its war with the freedom fighters. The U.S. provides weapons, including Russian-built AK-47s and American anti-aircraft missiles to the freedom fighters in the hopes to repel the Soviet attack. The Soviet Union suffers heavy casualties and economic problems and increasing opposition to the war at home, and formally withdraws in February of 1989. Due to economic issues, the Soviet Union could not support the nuclear arms race or the war in Afghanistan. Under Mikhail Gorbachev, Glasnost was implemented as an attempt at economic reform, but was largely ineffective. The Western Soviet bloc breaks away from Moscow control, and member states leave the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union formally collapsed in 1991 and officially ends the Cold War and establishes the Democratic Russian Federation.
Technology and transportation are two areas that our country still expands on today. It all began with inventions such as Thomas Edison's light bulb and the telephone invented by Alexander Graham Bell. Later on down the road, this would lead to televisions and your modern-day computers.
Yeah, it looks like they're accessing my mainframe.
Railroads were built all throughout the Western expansion, and by the 1920s, automobiles had risen to the top. It's inventions like these that have had the greatest social impact throughout American history.
Oh yeah, this'll look classy.
How do you want me to start the process?
Lower. First, I would say...
Okay, we'll
just bring in Ruckus right there. That looks good. Yeah, I like it.
I was born in 1933, so I have no memory of the dust storm. However, I do. Excuse me.
Yeah, that's what you were doing.
Abolition.
Ended on, or we can pick it back up from slavery.
Good. I turn off the light, you can't see me.
That's such a lie.
Back on and strain in my eyes a bit.
Oh, thanks, Anna. Guess what? The demand for public education began to grow as a need for a more educated electorate.
Brooklyn was already like that.
Go. Hello, I'm Kaylin, and signing off with you today. I'd like to give a special thanks to all my guests on the show and my lighting man, Stan.
That was such a good take!
The entire time,
could I have been better?
The entire time, I had the biggest grin on my face, and I couldn't get rid of it.
Just a happy lady grin.
We'll start over.
I can't believe I did spit.
Six,
nothing.
27, and action.
I began the women's 10%.
Here, she might talk like that.
And we're rolling.
I don't think she said the wrong
And
thing.
We're rolling in 2-1, action.
I began the women's 10% movement.
I can't even read. Women's Christian Temperance Union. Say it.
Women's Christian Temperance Union.
We learned about it. Remember?
Yeah, I remember that. I never
the
had to say it.
Women's Christian Temperance Union.
It's a mouthful. Let's see this.
Okay. Study.
Does this work if I hold it here?
I'm recording this all, so.
Does this work if I hold it here?
Yeah. Yeah. Except that you're looking down for the entire time.
Your recording is.
This is a good blooper roll.
Oh.
It's been 2 weeks now since we started this project. We've all made it so far, but some of the others, I doubt they'll make it. Peter's very weak. I doubt they'll make it. Oh, here he comes now.
It feels alive with the sound of music. The wild dogs cry out in the night.
That's all I know.
And get to the horses. Peter, the British are coming!
The British? They didn't come now, America.
That's the British and she's approaching. They'll approach.
Is this going?
I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.
All right, restart.
It's only two lines. How'd you miss it?
Nothing to wonder.
Where I picked this.
No, that's later. You need to give the rest of your spiel, right? Or...
Don't move, Pete.
Well,
no, because he has to do
the
whole
the spiel's like... gonna be the lumberjack. This is gonna be. Now I'm gonna do the one where I say, before we do this, let me slip into something more comfortable.
And then so are you gonna blow the flower?
So grab. Yeah. So then I say, so grab your pillows, your pen and paper, and let's get to this. And then I grab it and blow.
Yeah.
What?
I'm sorry.
Alright. I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay. I sleep all night and I work all day. I got the town trees. Oh wait, no, I'm doing something, joked around before, but I think it's actually true, though. Hey, Laura. Hey, guys. Do you want
to be in my video? Yeah. All right,
sit in this chair. Oh, pull that chair. I'll have to think of something to say.
You can interview.
I don't know.
Are you on a mission?
As we all know, the Germans lost. And then I can say,
the Germans failed.
Yeah, but the next step in recuperating from the war was the Treaty of Versailles.
Hold on, ready? Film.
There's like a...
It's filming.
Hey.
In what is known as the Hundred Days.
Oh! Oh shit.
Dude, it's a honeybee, they don't sting you.
What, Peter?
It's a honeybee, they don't sting you.
Okay.
Where'd that butterfly go?
Alright, let's go.
Okay, why am I running upstairs? That's just gonna make me hot.
Yeah, since you're done, I need you to do me a favor.
You looking for somebody?
Okay.
Okay. Oh, I know what he's looking at. Why is Peter sitting on the desk? That's what he's wondering.